kind of got to wonder about why people do the same thing over and over again when it fails and expect different results the next time. That absolutely describes many homeowners, especially with their lawns. Now, I'm not big on growing a monoculture lawn. I know how. I know it adds a lot to the eye candy appeal and the value of the property, but it is not a pursuit I plan to ever engage in my own lawn. Therefore, if you want a pristine lawn that makes your neighbors jealous and the local golf courses marvel at your secrets, you're going to have to do as I say, but not as I do. I include this lawn care section not because I think monoculture lawns are a good idea. Quite the contrary. I do so because there are so many manic homeowners frothing at the mouth to have beautiful lawns. It's your yard. It's your project. I'm just the information guy here. A little history of lawns in America. Through the 1940s, the prominent lawn cover was not grass, it was clover. Clover is a hardy, broad-leafed plant that is easy to mow, grows slowly, is soft to the barefoot, looks very good as a cover, needs little or no fertilization, and even as a perk, contributes nitrogen to the soil for other plants to use. But it's a broadleaf plant. Problem is, for the corporations running the fertilizer and chemical companies, was weed control. There's no selective herbicide that kills one kind of broadleaf plant and not all the others as well. There are, however, chemicals that either kill only grasses or there are chemicals that kill only broadleafed plants. In order to have a weed-free looking lawn, it is far easier to do so starting with a grass with the base crop than a clover. So a massive radio and newspaper campaign deluged America for nearly a decade. Do you want your children stung by bees? Get rid of that clover. Put in a new and improved grass lawn and be the envy of the neighborhood. Well, they could now sell you a host of chemicals that they could not before with clover lawns. Once again, corporation greed and foolish consumers were a match made in Wall Street. So if you ask me what the best grass is to put in your lawn, my answer is clover. But you aren't going to do that, so let's discuss the corporate propaganda's conventional possibilities. Suckers. For persons. For persons in zones 5 and 6, tall fescue is the grass of choice. It was developed in the 1930s, and there are now hundreds of strains. K31 was the original and still on the market today, but don't buy it. It is an inferior strain. It grows in clumps and fails to reseed itself as do its descendants. Also, don't buy Scott's, Rebel, or Pennington grass seeds. The best advertised products are always the worst. North Carolina University tests for the top 100 strains of both bluegrass and tall fescue every year. They publish their results online. I recommend you get a blend of grass seed that is on their list, but don't plant it yet. Wait till fall. Just search for top performing tall fescue study, North Carolina University, in a search engine online. And you should be able to get a list of those seeds I would recommend. For those in zones 5 and 6, I would be reluctant to plant a bluegrass lawn. This grass does better in cooler climates and is prone to fungus and heat stress. if you live in zones 4 or 3, it is likely a better choice, though again, tall fescue is probably still a hardier grass. If you go south to zone 7, fescue is still an option, but more and more one sees zoysia and Bermuda or centipede or St. Augustine grasses. Those are the southern grasses. They're very hardy, but lay dormant for longer periods of time after cold weather ends. The further south one goes, the more one sees these grasses and lawns. I love zoysia, even here in zone 5. Its only drawback is that it stays brown 6 months of the year. When it greens up, it's like a magic carpet. But as green as lawn, it's a short ride. In southern zones, we get more and more green for longer and longer periods because they have a shorter cold period. In the shady part of your lawn, no matter what zone you're in, small fescue is about the only choice. Though it cannot take a full afternoon sun, nor can it take no afternoon sun at all, but if you're in that middle place, just right, 2 to 3 hours of direct sunlight, it is the grass none can surpass. If you have more shade in less than 2 hours of full sun, you must switch to a ground cover like liriope, which can grow in full shade. It looks like grass, but is in fact a lily. Most southern grasses are planted as either sod or plugs, while seed is preferred for the fescues and bluegrasses. Those two can be bought as sod, but at a considerable greater cost. Try to find seed for St. Augustine or zoysia is about impossible. Spring is the time for sod or plugs, but not for grass seed. Why we don't plant grass seed in the spring. This right here is a chart that shows the cold through the heat, through the cold of the season. Start out in January cold, middle of July is where you have most heat, December you're back into cold. This also corresponds with the amount of root growth that one has. Roots only grow in cold weather. The tops of the plants grow in the heat. Therefore, you have to keep this in mind when planting. Overseeding in spring ensures very little root growth. Roots grow in cool and cold weather, tops grow in the heat. So here we are in May. You've already planted your grass in April. The tops of the grass are very thick. However, you are very shallow rooted. Plants in the spring give the false impression of success in May. The grass comes in thick and beautiful, but with shallow roots that are very fragile in the heat. By June, wet conditions and warm nights cause fungus. Juvenile grass, thickly planted before, cannot resist the fungus and dies. This is when the temperature at night is starting in the upper 70s and can go all the way up depending on how hot it gets. But the grass, being shallow rooted and susceptible to fungus, cannot stand the fungus when it comes along because it is not but juvenile. By July, drought by day and fungus by night finish off the new grass. Now you have nothing but bare ground, which is a perfect environment for a patch of weeds. So this is how we fail at planting grass, by doing it in the spring. Everyone blames the grass seed or some other condition that they don't like that make them frustrated. But every year they try and overseed the grass again, and this happens. Keep in mind that you can plant in the shade small fescue because it does not have a problem with fungus, neither does it have a problem with heat stress nearly as much. But that's only in areas where you get 2 to 3 hours of sunlight. You can also, in full sun, plant sod because it is established grass. So people ask, well, then what can I do in the spring to improve my lawn? There's going to be a wedding at my house, and I want the grass to look beautiful. Well, if the wedding's in June, that's about the time you're going to be having all the fungus if you plant. But something you can do is thicken your lawn, make things much improved, is to do an aeration. An aeration is done with a great big heavy machine that takes two men to lift. So usually people hire someone to do it. But hire it or rent it yourself. You want to do an aeration in the spring if you want your grass to thicken properly. Now, there are a couple of different kinds of aerators. There's one that's fairly light, and it just takes out, it just pokes holes in the ground. You want one that is a plug style aerator, not a spike style. When it's finished, it should be your yard looking like it's full of holes, and there's divots all over the place that all look like little tiny dog poops. This is kind of a side view of what the lawn would look like if you were, say, a gopher coming up out of it. You're going to have plug holes fairly close together with grass growing up between the plug holes and the dirt that didn't get pulled out. You need to make a lot of holes, not just a few. They need to be all about an inch deep. Imagine this is your yard here, whatever shape it is. You want to make three passes with that aerator. You want to make one that's diagonal back and forth. You want to make one that's perpendicular up and down. One that's horizontal back and forth, like so. Now, if you really want to gild the lily here and make your lawn look like it did come off of a golf course, you need to go out, rent a truck, or have delivered some manure. You want to put it down over the entire lawn. In order to accomplish that, you're going to need about 1 cubic yard for every 5,000 square feet of lawn. A cubic yard is 3 feet by 3 feet by 3 feet. And as you can see by the man standing here, that's quite a bit of maneuver just for 5,000 square feet. So if you got a 15,000 square feet of lawn, you're going to need 3 cubic yards of manure. In this illustration, you remember the other one. What we've added here is the manure, which is now filtered down into the plug holes. And you need to have it so that it's about a 1/4 inch deep around the grass. It'll find its way into those holes first time you start watering. What this does is allows air to go down into the roots, because the roots need air in compact ground. That's why the grass grows so poorly. Well, that nice, loam, thin dirt not only allows air to get down there, but it's full of micronutrients. So that grass is going to thicken like nobody's business. Now, the reason aeration is the second best thing you can do for your lawn is you must be feeding every 2 months. Now, there is an exception to doing any aeration. If your yard has wire grass, and you need to find out what that stuff is if you don't know, you do not want to do an aeration, not in the spring, not in the fall, not ever, until you kill off that wire grass. If you don't, the wire grass is going to take over your lawn and be nearly impossible to get rid of. So if you remember that you had wire grass from last year, you don't want to do an aeration. If you're not sure, I would hold off on doing an aeration until I was sure. It's going to start coming out and turning green right around the end of May. So you have time to still do an aeration even into June. I don't know that I'd go into July, but really an aeration at any time is not going to hurt. I'm not going to go into great detail today about how to plant grass seed. The reason being is I don't want you to plant grass seed. If you plant the grass seed, all the bad things that I showed you on the first poster are going to happen to you. You're going to have funguses. Funguses are very hard to get rid of. practically impossible. Unless conditions change, funguses tend to hang around. Even if you use expensive fungicides and switch off to other fungicides, they're gonna still have a fungus problem there. Things you have to do, even if you don't plant this time of year, to keep in mind are once June gets here, you have to cut back the watering a little bit. You don't want the lawn to be wet at night, if at all possible. Of course, we can't stop it when it rains. Rain is gonna come down in the nighttime sometimes, and you might get a fungus bloom. If you do, you're gonna have to get some fungicide to fight it or put up with it, one or the other. But that aeration I mentioned, that will help the drainage problem in your yard. When the grass is setting in puddles is where you're most likely to get fungus. Puddling hard ground in full sunlight is where all the fungus is gonna start. And you're gonna look at it and say, "Ah, oh, my grass is turning brown. I must need to water it more." Well, you just made a huge mistake there. And now you have a huge fungus bloom instead of a small one. So we have to keep in mind about fungus being a problem in June. What happens in July is the opposite problem. The rains usually stop, not always, but they usually start to dry up. So you have to water a lot just to keep the grass from drying up in that intense sunlight. But if you're watering too late in the afternoon or at night, then you got a problem. You wind up with a fungus at night and heat stress by day. So even a well-established lawn can really take a beating in July. It is our least favorite month for grass growing. If you can make a beautiful lawn in July, then you definitely have a green thumb. August is when we do all the good stuff. August is when, if we haven't done it yet, we aerate, we put down the manure, we put down grass seed, we let it start growing like crazy. And then just as the seasons change into September, the rain kicks in and Mother Nature does most of the watering for us. We save on the water bill, and it's cooler weather, the grass grows in well, and then voila, we have winter come along and the roots grow all winter long. So by the time they have to run into a July, they're at least 11 months old. It's a big advantage to plant in the fall. Those stupid corporations, though, they will try and sell you seed like crazy in the spring. I hardly ever see any advertisements for grass seed in the fall on either my television or my radio or in my newspaper. It's all done in the spring. And why is this? Because the corporations make a great deal of money if you fail. If you succeed, well, they're not going to sell you any more grass seed. You have a wonderful looking lawn. Why would you buy it? They want you to fail. They want you to plant in the spring. And then you see that beautiful grass come up in May and are fooled to think, well, the grass was great. I must have done something wrong. And so you keep going back and buying that stuff from them. They're making money and they're fooling you by telling you to plant that time of year. Don't do it. Corporations, I'm not going to say they're evil, but in the lawn business, I tell you, I have seen so many shenanigans over the years. I remember when I first started out, I worked for a little mom and pop operation called Lawn Green. They were honest. I didn't know what I was doing, but they were honest. They gave us good products to put down. I even wrote a little song about it while I used to work for it. Lawn green, prettiest green grass what ever been seen. All the girls are sassy and the bosses lean at good old Lawn Green. I make my living taking care of your lawn at good old Lawn Green. Tie lights to the spreader and we'll work till dawn at good old Lawn Green. I fight all kinds of lawn disease, kill bugs and fungus, and sometimes trees. I drink lots of beer and I aim where I please at good old Lawn Green. Any rate, the song never caught on, but it was a fun place to work. But then I switched when I moved to another town and I worked for True Green, which was not nearly as nice a company. It's owned by Waste Management. It's probably the biggest grass service company in the country. Those people, they use bad chemicals. They had a storage facility for overflow chemicals. When you had to get rid of them, they were supposed to keep them and send them off to the to special dump sites. But that thing was always full. So what they would have their technicians do is take their sprays and go out and spray it all over the nearby fields, just kind of chemical dumping, really. I thought it was atrocious. I, you know, refused to do it. I said, I am not going to go dump chemicals in a field. The other thing I disliked about that company was they had a bonus policy. They'd give you starvation wages unless you made your bonus, and then you could live pretty good. You get around 20 grand a year, which back in those days was a lot of money. But in order to make that bonus, you would have to have spent 5 minutes per lawn between driving 15 minutes to the next one. Well, there's not a whole lot of lawns you can properly take care of in 5 minutes. So I never made my bonus, but I took care of people's lawns properly. I finally quit there when they, I came back from a leave of absence after my son was born. And I got in my truck, drove out to someplace in DC, which had a 300,000 square foot of lawn in an apartment complex. Tried to fire up my spreader, which was a spray style. I don't recommend those for killing weeds. Great big power one. And whoever had used my truck while I was gone had fouled the plugs on the thing and it wouldn't start. So I called them and they had me go to a Sears store and buy a spark plug, which I put in the thing. And I said, look, it's already 1 o'clock in the afternoon. There's 300,000 square feet here. I could be spraying here till 9 o'clock at night. They said, we don't care, just get it done. So I said, no, you get it done, and I quit. And there's a lot of other lawn companies that pull little foolish tricks like that. The idea is if they only allow you 5 minutes per lawn to work, well, a lot of those young kids will just show up there, fill out the paperwork, stick it in the door, and not do anything else. How are you going to know? Did your lawn get treated? Sure, there's a little flag they left in your lawn. I've even had, as a homeowner, them do that to me. Show up at my house by mistake because I didn't have a lawn service, stick a sign in my front lawn, and then hand me the bill. Well, it was for the neighbors, and I, having been in the lawn care business, could tell what they put down and what they didn't. I called up the company and I said, give me one good reason why I shouldn't report you to the Better Business Bureau, the newspaper, and especially to my neighbor. So be very careful as consumers out there. There are a lot of bad characters that are trying to run lawn services and cheat you, just like Scott's likes to cheat you. And Pennington doesn't really cheat you. They just use really crappy products. Same with Rebel. Rebel at one time was a pretty good brand, but they've gone downhill. They'll keep their weed seed around in storage bins for 20 years sometimes before they put it on the market. Well, it's much better to start with fresh seed. Now, admittedly, 20-year-old seed will sprout, but you're paying for a lot of seed that's already seen its day and gone on to grass heaven. So those brands I don't recommend. Every year they develop new strains of the tall fescue, and that North Carolina University chart that tells you about them, that's the one you want to go by. You may have to special order the grass seed online, but in the long run, spending a few dollars for shipping and getting the right seed is going to save you hundreds of dollars trying to repair the problem with really bad seed that you buy from a lot of the nurseries who are woefully ignorant about lawns too. They're busy, you know, moving plants out of Florida. They don't know anything about grass care. They were never out in the field like I was for years. So again, if you're going to be a good consumer, know something about the products you're getting. Know something about the companies you're dealing with. When you go in and talk to them, ask them questions. If they seem to not know what they're talking about, guess what? They don't know what they're talking about. You need to find someone who does. So that's pretty much all I had to say for today. We're doing new editing techniques, so we're going to post this film kind of raw right away, but then we'll have an edited version coming out in a few days. I want to say good to have you in the class again, and good gardening, people.